Wow. That's how the 24th opens up. First, there was a high-pitched ringing from somewhere. How extraordinary. Okay, welcome to the 24th of July. My best advice is to sit on the sidelines. That's my best advice. And then this will be the situation right now is, I would say, super tricky. Too tricky for anyone to be definitive about what's really going on. I can explain what's going on, and yet when it gets right down to it, when the push is made, which it is now being made, you go along almost like on autopilot, like you're supposed to, you've been set up to react in a certain way. This is what I've seen in the dream last night. I was in this movie theater, and there's this woman there, this girl, and she had her baseball hat, but it was on backwards. I remember she had it on backwards. And she's talking, we're listening, we're conversing, she's asking me questions and stuff. And then I found myself in this big truck driving, and she was there. Or some woman was there, and then she said, okay, it's my turn to drive. And so she got out of the truck and walked around towards where I was, and I got out, and I went to switch. And then I woke up in the dream, and I said, wait a minute. So where is this script coming from that we're supposed to switch places as far as who's driving the truck? Okay, who's scripting that? But I was like just doing automatically, like, I said, well. But my mind cannot seem to get traction at this point. Like we're just supposed to automatically switch places. Who's driving the truck? Based on what? A decision like that, I mean, it is what it's all decided? No, I felt like we're doing this. Why? It's expected of us. Well, who's expecting it of us? So. But I was going along like a zombie. It's like, uh-oh, we're more zombified than we realize. Okay, so now we're getting to the heart of what all these videos are about, which is humility. Okay. And the mood of repentance, which says, I may be more zombified than I realize. Okay? I have a very severe problem, a continuity fear problem. So this problem is so severe, it's interfering with my clarity. So, yes, we've been trying to clarify here and doing a great job of it, but the overall message has always been mood of repentance, full stop on the wow, willingness to sit on the sidelines for a while until the dust settles, and not thinking that I say the situation is going to be so tricky, will be so tricky, that we're in great danger of simply being pulled along by it, in spite of all of our clarifications that we've made. So I've always said clarify as much as we can. But at the crucial point, be humble and realize the continuity fear problem is extremely severe. It's the only problem we have, but it's just extraordinarily severe, actually. So even though we've made a lot of progress towards liberation from the belief that perception's a need, when push comes to shove, we will need to sit on the sidelines for a while and let the dust settle. So, in the dream, the remedy I had was I was already out of the driver's seat, and the woman was coming over to go into the driver's seat. And so I thought, oh, wait a minute. Why don't I just say, you know what? If you want to drive, that's fine. Or not so fine, I don't know. But I don't really want to be driving a truck right now. I'm tired of driving this vehicle. And I'm tired of riding in this vehicle. And I'm tired of, you know, going through traffic. Whether I'm a passenger or a driver, I'm tired of it. So I want to take a break from this vehicleness, so to speak. But more like, let this vehicle be there, but I'm just not going to get into it. So I'm not going to be into a vehicle, meaning a body. So the body can remain, but I'm not going to be into it. So the question is, who is in charge of our, what we do with our bodies? Okay, so we're changing over from a patriarchal situation to a matriarchal situation right now. Clinton, I guess, got a running mate yesterday. I didn't know that. I thought the convention started Monday. Today's Sunday. It was Saturday yesterday. Cain and Abel? Wasn't Cain the bad one? Cain and Abel. I don't know. Someone said something like that, but so it's now this switcheroo is taking place. But isn't the bigger question is, wait a minute, let's just look at the picture of a vehicle in the first place. Why am I in a vehicle driving along? Is that even right at all? Whether I'm a passenger or a driver, is that what's really important? Or is what's more important is what? Is there some bigger issue here? So, we feel there's a bigger issue. However, there's this autopilot zombification programming that is gripping us. And it's these expectations that we're going to act in a certain way. I've said that our expectations have been cultivated so that we're expected to go along in this way. Otherwise, you're terrible, you're wicked, you're horrible, all this stuff. And so I felt it in the dream. It's set now. It's the struggle between the matriarchy and patriarchy, however you want to look at it. Who's going to be dictating to everyone else? How do we use our bodies? What do we do with our bodies? What do we do with our attention? What do we do with our time, our how we focus, our focus? You know, all of this functioning. Who's going to be doing the driving and saying, okay, we're going to go here, now we're going to go here. The driver determines, you know, where you go. Although the men have been basically driving where the passenger, the woman wants them to go all along, actually. It's just that the woman doesn't quite trust the men anymore, is why she wants to drive. Before, she was a passenger because she said, okay, man, go on and go here. Okay, now you got to take me here. I'm going to go shopping here. And the man's just a chauffeur. But now she's saying, you guys, you know, you got a little flaky there. You heard Tibetan Buddhism and you kind of said, whoa, I'm going to drive over into this and listen to what they're saying. Said, no, so I can't really trust you anymore. So I got to do the driving now to make sure that we stay on track with this distraction, which we call a world. The world's just a distraction. So is there really a world? Or is it just a mental projection of distraction? So there's a big question of what the woman driving the truck means, isn't there? A very big question, Mark. However, I don't feel for me, it's possible to truly stand up to it at this point. This in the dream, I felt, wow, I can't stand up to this. What's going on? But I expected that this would take place. Is the conditioning that we've gone through over the last 60 years, and really 100 years in this world, is so extreme that we think we're just supposed to automatically go along with the culture and the shifts in culture. But keep in mind that culture is a cult designed to black out, to blind us. It's the blindness of arrogance. It's a cult designed to blind us to reality. So what we're saying is that the matriarchy now is will do a better job at blinding us to reality. Well, I don't doubt that at all. Certainly they will. Because they can candy coat the blindness. This is the yoga girl thing. They're going to candy coat the spiritual blindness. So my suggestion is to sit on the sidelines for a while and really be in the shadows, so to speak, in terms of what we're doing psychologically. We're into something else of just sitting quietly somehow. So just bear with us. Be a little patient right now. Be a little patient, because this is a super mega situation right now, and all our training is to wow it. Don't lose your patience at this point. Patience is the crucial ingredient right now. I got very impatient last night. I was very jittery. These closed Facebook groups, you submit your picture, your comment, and they have to approve it. And I've noticed a whole host of things of you have to be approved. And 99% I found of those who do the approving are women. 99%. I say, hey, wait a minute, what if I say something that doesn't go along with some agenda that they're following? Well, it's not going to get approved. So in order to have a voice in this world, you have to, as far as social media, everything. I mean, it's extraordinary. If you want to sign up for some retreat, you go through a whole network of women in terms of the approval. You know, they ask you questions about what's your orientation, what's your viewpoint about this and this and this. So they're very carefully screening you. You're being very carefully screened. And I found that almost all spiritual interaction in this world is now being very carefully screened by women. So if you want to be driving a truck in this world, or in a truck, you know, powerful vehicle, you have to be approved by women. Extraordinary tricky situation, isn't it? And so if you want to speak truth, which is to point out that this world is nothing but a distraction device, a desperate, arrogant distraction device, you're likely to... I don't know many women that would accept this. There may be a few. But by and large, 99.9% would reject this message, actually. Of course, so would 99.9% of men. It might be not quite as severe with men. But men tend to allow things to be a little more ragged. You know, a woman likes a very clean house. Very neat and clean. And men, you know, throw the clothes here, throw this dirty dust. What the heck? I'm not that bothered, you know, by it. Oh, you got a different viewpoint. Well, let me hear what you have to say. And we can put up a little raggedness here, you know. It's, don't have to be so. But when women are in charge, they're going to clean house. They're going to get the house exactly the way they want it, right? And this is what we're experiencing here right now. I'm certainly experiencing this. And I can't get into too many details about my work and all this kind of stuff. However, again, people are commenting, like, wow. The women are just cracking the whip on the men, saying, this is the way I want my house. And you have to make it happen, even if you have to work 24/7. And this, and it never stops. And the men are just like freaking out. They can't. It's like being way overburdened. So basically, they're putting their house in order. They say, this is the way we want our house to be. Your job is to make that happen for me. So they say, this is the way I want my house to be. Your job is to make it that way for me. But keep in mind the term, my house. This is the way I want my house to be. Whatever happened to our house? You know what? It never really was our house. Was it? But this is too much for us to handle. When the Dakini Chandra Sering children showed up, appeared here in California to me. She was laughing. I was trying to practice my golf swing. She's what you like just like, what are you trying to do? Trying to get it right, make it right. You know, I'm trying to make it right, you know, really practice to make it right. That's hilarious. Everything's already perfect. Just be spontaneous. Everything just be spontaneous. So she pointed out that there's nothing to set right in this world at all, actually. It's all completely flat. That's super grace. So we're having problems with women now at work, demanding too much of the men, and it's really an issue, actually. And they're basically saying, look, you're my slave. I'm driving. You're going to just do what I tell you to do. Okay, this is what's happening. And the men are getting all flustered and just shaking their heads, but they don't know what to do. Now, again, it's a supreme benefit for wisdom to be present. Whether it's a man or woman that has the wisdom, it's a supreme benefit for someone to be wise. So I've said the wise move, in the long term, it's a supreme benefit. The wise move is to say, whoa, we're going to just back off the whole situation right now. And we're not really going to do anything on the house to put the house in any sort of order, because there's grave questions about what direction we're actually going in. Very grave questions. The situation feels very slippery and tricky. And it seems very dubious what's been going on in this world. Extremely dubious. And yet we feel dutiful. Men feel very duty-bound. You know, okay, we'll let the women drive. We've been driving. But have we really been going in the direction that we want to go? Or has the women been dictating to us all along where we're going? So what is dictating, and what is dictating to the women? So who's dictating to us, actually? Is it men and women are dictating, or is there something else? Is it the ego? Is it our own arrogance? Not male arrogance or female arrogance, but spiritual arrogance. We're just puppets, and the spiritual arrogance is putting on this puppet show. And are we really, is putting women in charge of the world, is that really freeing us from spiritual arrogance? And my whole message is no, absolutely not. In fact, I say that they're extraordinarily arrogant, that the play of women is extraordinarily arrogant. But we're caught in this contrast. We've been tricked into this contrast between male and femaleness, thinking that men are the more arrogant ones and women are not. And my whole thing in my whole life is saying, no, that's not true at all. That's a trick. That's a trick that's leading us into a trap. Now, I don't think I can get... Hello, cat. Here's a cat coming. Beautiful male cat, actually. I don't believe I can get my voice heard in the mainstream of this world at all if I say that women are extremely arrogant and they desperately need to repent, and that men have actually been the ones who've worked the most on repentance, because they've been put in, they feel that they're in this very bad trap. And in no way are we going to automatically say, oh yeah, the best idea is just to go into a matriarchy. Wow. I don't have the... I'm shaken up. Ordinarily I could suppress a sneeze. So we're in this... So there you go. Inability to suppress a sneeze. Very rare for me. Maybe in the first time it's ever happened here. So the cat's wandering around. And it's looking. So if everything's being screened by feminists, then there's no way you can get this perspective into the mainstream here. It's impossible. This is the very perspective that they want to prevent. So the answer is, you know, do you go along in order to have a voice in the world? Or do you back off and not have a voice in the world? Or do you sit in the sidelines for a while and see how things settle out? For me, I'll sit on the sidelines. It takes patience. But I've been on the sidelines my whole life. There's no way in the world that we're going to be able to get the message of real repentance. At least at this point. Everyone is equal sinners. All arrogance is 100% arrogance. This is what I've said. Women are totally arrogant. Men are totally arrogant. Okay, so just changing drivers is a move designed to distract us from our spiritual path, actually. The real drivers are the ones who have the right spiritual message. So I'm not going to cede my driving to anyone. Other than a super guru, because I have the right message. What should be driving in the world is the right message, the right clarity, and that's not a male or female thing. It's a clarity thing. But this is lost right now. This clarity is simply not present in anyone in most in this world right now. Now I listen to Sri Sri Anandamayi, of course. She has the right advice. But listening to her doesn't mean that I'm going to automatically have the feminists take over my message. No, not at all. She'd never say anything like that. She was aware of the times. She says this marks the spirit of the times. And, you know, she always said there are benefits to everything. She never went negative, actually. Never. Virtually never. She would say, okay, well, what are the benefits? So she's just aware this is what's happening in the world. But she never strayed from her message. And went out of her way to help men, because men were actually starting to be spiritually oppressed and they wouldn't allow men to come see her. So you have to understand, I think it's a very, very good object lesson that Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the women around her said that you belong to us and you're empowering us. And they tried to shut the men out. So this shows you what the spirit of feminism is really about. Maybe she exposed it, is that women, they want to be the controllers of culture. Why? Arrogance and continuity fear. They haven't worked on their continuity fear. They're too blinded by materiality. Oh, look at all the material things I can get. And they spend their focus on that, looking at magazines, looking at television shows and all this stuff. How do I be more beautiful? How can I be more glamorous? How can I be more sophisticated? How can I be? Now, that has nothing to do with working on continuity fear. Continuity fear is just sitting here as nobody and nothing, quietly in the wow, and just allowing clarity to arise within you. That's what the real spiritual practice is. So I don't long ago stopped looking at all magazines, books, shut out television, shut out movies. So this is necessary. Are women doing that? Have they shut out all movies, all television, all entertainment? Have they shut out all magazines? All looking at bodies? Have they boycotted all this stuff? Because this is what is necessary. This is the austerity that's necessary, actually. Have they dropped concern about their body image? Have they dropped, all this? Have they boycotted all this? Maybe some have. But as far as a overallness, no, not at all. So they cannot claim to be in a mood of repentance. So we're going to turn over the driving of this world to those who are not in a mood of repentance? I don't think so. I'm not going to do that. But most of us say we've got to go along to get along right now. Anandamayi was like extremely austere. No identification with the body whatsoever. And they tried to glamorize her. They tried to. So the women wouldn't let the men. They formed this barrier around her. And they were very aggressive about it. She belongs to us. She's our mother. Nobody, no. Men, stay out. This is a woman's thing. And when it started out at Shabbat Gardens, at first only the women could come see her because the Navzadi belonged to her, the lady, the gardens did. And Pirobani, and so only women could come see her because it was a place where she invited the women to come into the gardens, but men were not allowed. Men were not allowed. So right there, you see this. And then what Anandamayi did was she was able to begin to make exceptions for men. She began to manipulate and allow men to start coming in through various means that she had. So in her life, it was the women certainly formed this sort of barrier, and that she always went out of her way to go around that, get around it. And she even advised, like Baiji, leave your wife. She said, or something, you need to take the spiritual path. You have the right to this. And she did not support the wives against the husbands. She supported spiritual practice above everything. So she was not a feminist. She's absolutely not a feminist. She said the spiritual path is the number one, is the top responsibility here, and everything else has to bow to that. And she always deferred to the male gurus, the ones who were very austere, who actually were doing it. She said, "No, I'll just sit here. You give the example here. I'm just empowering what you're doing." Austerity, 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 austerity. Was what she preached. Turn away from the glamour of the world. Be a renunciate. Be a spiritual renunciate. Now, you can do that as a householder. Some women can do that, absolutely. Some men can do that, absolutely. But the women that are trying to drive the be the drivers of culture. They're not austere. They're not renunciates. They're not repentant. So why should we go along with them just because they say that we're supposed to? Why? None of the boxes are checked at all. And so we're supposed to just be whimsical. And of course, they say, yeah, of course, this is what this whole world is about, is whimsicality, protecting whimsicality. And I say, well, I don't need to protect whimsicality. I say, well, we all do. What are you talking about? Well, these are people who have not repented, and they refuse to admit they have a continuity fear problem. See, when we admit that we have a continuity problem, severe kind problem, this is repentance. And the benefit is that we then become aware. This is all just our own whimsical arrogance. So the decisions we're making is just whimsical. We're asked to simply be whimsical and absurd. And we think absurdity is profundity. But when you repent, you say, wait a minute, absurdity is not profundity. What are you talking about? It's severe continuity fear. But if we don't repent, we think severe continuity fear is some sort of great profundity within us. It's very, very profound. And we make decisions based on that, and we think we're making profound decisions. We're making absurd decisions. It's absurd to put Hillary Clinton in the White House, for instance. Totally absurd. On every level. And yet, people think this is profound. There's something extremely profound. And as far as putting Trump in, it's pragmatic. It's pragmatic. He's got rough edges. He's ragged. Yeah. We don't expect perfection of pragmatism in this way. But it's just simply for me, I just say, well, overall, that's the pragmatic thing to do. Okay. I'll stay calm about it, stay focused, and I'm not in some frenzy or, oh, this is going to be great. Oh, yeah. No. But it's the pragmatic move. Keep things balanced. Don't let either side get a stranglehold on the other. There's some things that really need to be, got to stand up to the Chinese, okay? Trump's way better at that. Way, way better. And there's a whole bunch of things that pragmatically we have to take a stand and stand up to it and deal with this. And he's willing to do that stuff. So much better at it. Way, way better. Clinton is just on a whimsical, a trip of whimsy, an ego trip. There's no pragmatism. It's an ego trip. But people think the ego is profound. People believe the ego is profound because they have not repented. When you repent, my experience was, I said, okay, I'm going to drop my identification with the world. When I was about 20, I decided I'm going to do this, like Ramana Maharshi did it. And then this massive tsunami of dread and fear suddenly arose in me, and I said, what the heck? Because I first identified with the world, and I said, okay, I'm going to try to drop the world. What's going to happen? I wanted to find out what was going to happen. And what happened was this tsunami of dread arose. And then I realized, wow, that's continuity fear. The Holy Spirit pointed out to me, the only thing standing in your way, the Holy Spirit pointed out to me, is continuity fear. Actually, when I was 20, I was enlightened. I went through this enlightenment, a realization. And then the Holy Spirit, I was aware, okay, and then it started slipping away, and the Holy Spirit said, okay, notice, just notice, which I did, full stop in the way, I just noticed what's happening. And then the Holy Spirit said, okay, you're going to go back into this fog, okay, but then this is the only problem you have. We're just going to work on evaporating this fog. And I agreed to that, say, okay. And so this began a very intense sadhana, which is the super intensity from that point, about 39 years of evaporating the continuity fear. Has Hillary Clinton spent 39 years in a cave evaporating her continuity fear? And so we're supposed to follow her as if she's the Messiah or something? People I've talked with about Trump, they're like, you know, yeah, you know, this, they're kind of weighing it. And I said, well, you know, but they say, yeah, he'd be all right. They're not like this, thinking like, here comes the new age, you know, this is great. Here comes the messianic age. And it's time for this big change. We got to put women in charge, as if that's the issue. So what the issues? These pragmatic issues, China, and China's attitude in the world. You know, Wall Street, corruption of speculation, being bought and paid for by the lobbyists and the corrupt Wall Street and all that stuff. Trump's his own person. He's his own person. He's direct. He's blunt. He's candid. He says what he feels. This is helpful. This is helpful. We need to get that mood back of that we can feel, we can speak up and say what's on our mind. Not so politically correct. He's not politically correct. So all these things are pragmatic balances. So, you know, people I've talked to say, yeah, I can see that would be very helpful. But there's not this idea like that we're making this power shift into, you know, the right culture, finally, you know, put women in charge and everything will be fine. Like, what? I thought we're supposed to put repentance in charge of culture. And of course, women will say, well, we're naturally repentant. Guess what? I've worked at it for 39 years and I know what it's all about. And they're not naturally repentant. That's a lie. What they're able to do is they're able to sugarcoat their non-repentance. Very cleverly, they're able to camouflage their non-repentance. That's what they're really good at. And that's a very dangerous thing, which is why men generally tend to be in charge of repentance, just because they're much less adept at camouflaging their lack of repentance. It's easy to see a man's a sinner. It's much more difficult to see a woman's a sinner. She can put on all sorts of airs and camouflages as though, you know, fashion. You know, dress up in, dress her personality or persona up in a fashionable way. It seems the fashion of repentance, where it's not true repentance. So it's more deceptive. It's very difficult to see, is a woman really repentant or not? It's very difficult. I mean, the Dharma kings can, so I'll let them be the judges of that. Now, repentance is a gut thing. It's very strong. You're either repentant or you're not. When that tsunami of dread hit me, I realized, wow. And when I had this enlightenment experience and I saw it slipping away, I realized it galvanized my entire being. And said, this is what I have to do with my life. And this absolutely supersedes everything else, including marriage, family, you know, children, in-laws, grandchildren, housing, food, everything. It knocked everything else out, that even food was not important. And it's still not important. Money's not important. Money wasn't important. Food, retirement, the future, nothing else. That's true repentance. Is nothing else is important. That this is the sun. This is my sun that is shining in my life. That's repentance. That's not a fashion. That's not an accessory. So women are extremely adept at they do this to kind of like whatever the man is into, she pretends to be into it also. So she can get help in focusing on family and whatever she wants to focus on. This is how this is the nature, the setup of nature. Remember, male and female, as we're functioning here, are part of this of nature, which is a mental projection of arrogance from spirit. So if we go, if spirit says, oh no, it's nature's natural, and perception is a need, then we will continue to follow along nature. And in nature, the woman has to convince the man that she's into what he's into, so he'll agree to stick with her. But she may not have the slightest interest. Most of the time, women don't have the slightest interest in what men are interested in. They pretend to be interested, but they're not at all. And then later on, the man finds out, God, we don't have anything in common. She's not at all interested in what I'm interested in. I was completely deceived. This is totally typical in this world. Repentance is not an interest. It's a total conviction. It's not for sale through some relationship. You don't barter it. There's nothing to barter. It's not some business deal or a bartering thing. She says, well, I'll be a little interested in repentance if you be interested in what I'm interested in. No, I'm 100% interested in repentance, and I'm not interested in anything else. And most of us here don't get that, including the women, but women are way more clever at pretending to be interested. They say, maybe I can get something out of this if I just pretend to be interested, that kind of thing. So, you know if you're repentant or not. You know. You've had the experiences. I've had so many experiences in my life, totally all based around repentance. So people asking questions about this. What are you asking questions? What do you mean? You should be saying, my house is on fire. I have this extreme problem, continuity problem. It's burning my house down. What can I do? Practice, full stop on the wow. Okay, I am practicing now. That's it. I have to realize the truth, this life. And I have to do it right now. Today. That's how I feel every day. I have to be realized today. No excuses. No excuses. And so this pushes away all superfluous stuff. It pushes it away, pushes it away, pushes it away. You cannot be interested in the new age, the new world. What is that? Your house is on fire. Your hair is on fire. How do you put it out? Or how do you get free of it? This world is a house on fire. So what do? Find another house. So if the women want to drive the truck, like in the dream, find another vehicle. I'll find another vehicle. I'm not going to be a passenger in of a vehicle that is being driven by a non-repentant mindset. And yet, the key is, because of our conditioning, of our expectations and social pressure, we're not really able to assert that here in this world effectively. I've tried, but you know, it doesn't get traction. So what we need to do is say, well, yeah, I'm gonna take a little break, a little bathroom break here, as far as before we get into the truck. I might get into that. Not right this moment. But I'm going to take a little break here. And just take that break. Don't decide one way or the other. This is full stop in the wow. So we can hear the flipping of the script and what our options are. But in terms of choosing, right now I think it's important to say, I'm not choosing either right at this moment. I'm going to let the dust settle. And see if there's another option. See what the options really are. It's going to let the dust settle. And that's difficult to do, but we can do this. This takes an effort of will. Keep in mind, again, the continuity fear is extremely severe. And those who are in the grip of continuity fear are actually believing that absurdity, arrogance, absurdity, whimsicality is God, is something profound, and they're being guided by God. And so they feel self-righteous that what they're doing is what God wants to be done, because this is how nature is moving now, as if nature is some sort of autonomous force of wisdom instead of just being a mental projection of arrogance. So they believe that they're doing God's will. And they say, well, you have to, you know, if you want to be good and not left behind by God, you got to go along with the flow of nature and God's will. And I say, well, yeah, absolutely. But right, I'm just taking a little break here to catch my breath. And I'm not going to go along with right now. But, you know, sometime in the future, you know, I might. So you have to buy yourself a little time is what's important right now. So this is what I'm focusing on to help you out. Now, maybe I could get free of it. Okay, maybe. But as far as helping everyone else, there's not too many people in the world who have dedicated their entire life to repentance, really. Because even up until the last 20, I was completely focused on this whole issue. I just didn't start this intense, discipline and as far as working on continuity fear until I was 20, you might say. So I really spent my entire life on all this and almost 40 years of intense 24/7 effort on evaporating continuity fear. There's not many who can say that here. Very few. So those that I'm trying to help, they may not be quite ready to just, stand up to it all easily. So we just can probably walk away from the situation a little bit is what's required. That's the quail. Quails don't, they walk, they run, but they don't fly. And our friend here made a comment here of walk, run, but don't fly. Brilliant. Great advice. Perfect advice. So this quail showing up showed us we can walk away from the situation, we can run away from it, but don't expect ourselves to fly away from it quite yet. So don't be like trying to fly and say, I can't fly, I can't fly, I can't fly, and then collapse into discouragement. Now first walk away and then run away. And then we'll see, we'll talk about flying at that point. So we're not rejecting it yet, but we are walking away from it, and then we're going to run away from it, and then we'll see if we can fly away from it. So that quail showing up, that was like an intense messenger of the Holy Spirit, of super grace. Quail walk away, as you get close to them, they start walking away casually. As you get a little closer, they scurry away a little more. If you go too close to them, they run real fast. Now, they may flutter their wings a little bit, but generally, quail don't fly. They can run real fast. And they're in the bushes. They don't get too far away from the bushes. They don't stray too far away. So if anything comes, they run into these bushes real quickly, and they're safe there. So this was the message. That this is the message. Is let's start walking away from it. Walk away from it. So my workouts are stepping. I step away. I go up steps. I work on steps. Now I'm up to 3 steps at a time now. I can go up 3 steps at a time. Stairs, three steps at a time. At first I did singles, then I did doubles, now I'm able to do triples, but boy, the triples, wow. Wow, wow, wow. I may just keep working on triples, because that really, you gotta dig down for that. So my advice to you is start with singles, then you'll start naturally just feeling you can do doubles, and then at some point, I saw this yoga girl doing triples. I said, wow. I noticed that. And then next time I started, I tried to do triples. Because this requires that you, it uses it more than your legs, your whole body has to launch itself to step 3 steps at a time, going upstairs. Try going 3 stairs at a time. Find some stairs near where you live. Find some stairs. It could be a building, like a flight of stairs, you know. Instead of taking the elevator, take the stairs and go try 1 stair at a time, then try 2 at a time, and then try 3 at a time. Go up like 5 flights of stairs or something, taking 3 stairs at a time. So the message is coming from different variety of angles now. We've had some confirmations in various ways. Don't try to fly right now. Don't try to fly. It's interesting that Southwest got all messed up and we had someone was going to fly and then it was possible they're not going to fly. That was another confirmation. Don't fly right now. Don't try to fly. Don't try to fly away yet. Because you may feel that you're a failure. And that'll collapse your will. Trust in the supergurus. I've already been invited to go dwell and visit Jesus' place. And he starts out with a visit. You know, he didn't say, you gotta stay there. He said, well, you would like to come, you know, come visit me, my place. Come see my place. I said, yeah, absolutely, yes. I said, okay, great. So, this is, you know, this is a mindset, right? It could be also a place, but that reflects this mindset, echo. So, the super gurus know the way. They know how to fly, okay? But you don't go to somebody who has massive continuity fear and say, okay, time to fly. You go to them and say, look, it's time to start walking. And then it's time to start running. And then it's time to, ultimately, when you feel comfortable to fly, you can fly. The intermediate step of perception, clearly perceiving that perception is a choice, not a need. This might be said to be running. Full stop on the wow is walking. The practice we're doing is walking. Clearly perceiving that perception is a choice, not a need, that one insight settles it all. That's running. And then ultimately, knowing is flying. We're not ready to fly. Nobody here is ready to fly. The super grace, super gurus are, yeah, the Dharma kings. But they approach us and say, no, you need to walk first. So you need to practice first, then perceive the perception, clearly perceive the perception is a choice, not a need. And then we'll decide who does the driving, where we're being driven to. But until we perceive the perception is a choice, not a need, we're simply being governed by absurdity, the continuity fear. And we're not in our right mind to make any that type of choice at all. So we're not willing to make a big switcheroo of culture, because that takes us away from our practice. Conservatism really is saying, let's leave everything the way it is and let's just go to church more. That's the right attitude, actually. Let's not try and fix everything. Let's first go to church more. That's the first fix. In other words, let's first go to full stop on the wow more. That's the first step in fixing whatever is broken, because we're not quite sure what's broken. What's broken is our desire to fail. That's a tricky thing. What's broken is a way of saying our belief. We have a wrong, mistaken belief that we can break reality, and we don't need to try and fix that belief up. Maybe it's starting to break up itself, right? The idea that we can break up reality, well, then we think that we can break up. And so we're starting to break up, we need to fix it. No, we're not. If we cannot break up reality, we cannot break up ourselves. So our self is not broken. So all we're doing is saying that our will to keep on trying to change reality is starting to fragment, and we've got to fix that. We've got to fix it. And you get this messianic feeling like, yeah, we got to fix this, folks. I want to, this crazy look, the self-righteous look, the Hillary Clinton, that look. It's just like, whoa, no. We got to fix it. We're starting to lose our will to stay focused on absurdity. Got to fix it. So first, let's fix going to church more. Okay, that's the most important aspect. That's the most broken thing in the world, as people have gotten away from their spiritual austerity, moral austerity. Okay, number one, let's get back to moral austerity. Let's get back to personal, materialistic austerity. Let's get back to praying more and practicing more, meditating, contemplating, praying more. Let's bring prayer back into public places and forums. Secularity was never supposed to push it out of the public forum, marketplace at all. First fix all that, because that's what's most out of whack. And I don't hear the candidates focusing on that so much, right? So this is what our candidate Dzogchenpa is focused on. So I'm helping you understand Dzogchenpa for president is kind of this way we have of saying, well, wait a minute, we want to focus on our candidate for a little while, Ms. Clinton and the Donald. Let's focus. We're going to focus on our president and what our president can bring before we worry about trying to decide between these two, because maybe we don't want either one of them, actually. So we want to spend a little time getting familiar with our candidate. Thank you very much. Who is it that's dictating to us what our candidate has to be, who we have to be focused on? Really? We're bound to two parties and that's our choice? Wait a minute. Who's dictating that? I mean, the Green Party has their candidate, don't they? Why can't the non-dualists have their party too? Their candidate. So we have to understand we're in this profoundly idealized, self-righteous, politicized world. And I just think it's stupid to think that we can ignore that. Unless we're sitting, going forward, I really feel, so I put this Dzogchenpa for president thing. Nothing has happened with it yet. It's typical. But maybe something will. I put it up there. I put the flag up there. Let's see who salutes. We have to sit on the sidelines right now. This is my perspective. In order to do this, we need some, most of us are just trying to learn how to walk on the path, let alone run. But we can get to the point of running, but we should not try to fly. So if you're just learning to walk, and there's this intense ideological pressure in the world of which way are you leaning, this way or that, you say, well, I'm actually considering this third party candidate. And it's just like someone mentioned, he supported Ron Paul. The only candidate he supported was Ron Paul, and he was disillusioned with that. And I heard that, I said, huh, interesting. Yeah, that's a third party candidate, wasn't it? He said, hey, let's have a different platform we focus on. So this is what they say, these are the things we need to fix. We need to get back to austerity, moral austerity, personal austerity, materialistic austerity. That's the first thing we need to do. So Dzogchenpa is all for that. So is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. So are the Dharma kings. So we're not going to wear sackcloth right now, okay? That's not the point. It's an inner austerity of mind. So I'll hang out at a nice place and but my mood is austere, you know. It's a mood. It's an attitude. No nonsense. No nonsense, really. Now, hippie, super hippie stuff. Yeah, but that's not nonsense. That's profound, because that's breaking us out of this robotic zombie-like state that we're programmed. And we're supposed to go along. Yeah, which of these two parties do you support? Well, I support a third party. Well, they can never win. Yeah, but they can help me get oriented in the right direction by helping me focus on what's most important for my life. Because neither one of these candidates are helping me focus on what's more important for my life. And people say, what? They can't win. Well, they can win with me. I got my vote. So I'm going to continue to, whoever wins the presidency, I'm going to continue on supporting Dzogchenpa in his candidacy to ultimately win the presidency. So I didn't win this time, next 2020, then. And then, not then, 2024. So we're already starting to get groundswell for Dzogchenpa to be president, maybe in 2020. How about that? Dzogchenpa for president in 2020. And let's start a grassroots movement for that. And this is marketing austerity. The mood of austerity, the mood of repentance, is marketing repentance to people. Genuine repentance, which supersedes any religion, so to speak. If you're really serious, you are not going to get trapped by labels and names, okay? Well, the name of Jesus is the only name, and that this name. No, by whatever name you call super grace, it's still super grace. So don't get trapped by labels, by names, by words. When you're really repentant, you practice the wow and experience the clarity that arises within you. You directly experience the clarity that arises within you. That's the real path. And you don't just try to describe it or label it or measure it or name it right off the bat at all. And whatever you say about it is a convention. It's mere convention. And the convention does not have authority over the experience, direct experiencing. It's the direct experiencing that has authority. That's why the Dharma kings have authority, because they have directly experienced this and are directly experiencing it right this moment. So they're the ones who have true authority. Conventions are conventions. They can be useful, but they're not authoritative. Plain and simple. They're not authoritative. They're pragmatic. And we certainly do honor pragmatism. Absolutely. I'm super pragmatic. But it's pragmatism is not authoritative. It is not ultimately authoritative. It's our own experiencing of clarity that's authoritative, because that is reality. Reality is authoritative. Reality is authoritative. So Dzogchenpa is a formless candidate, has no form and no real name. No name, no form. Maybe Padmasambhava is the vice president of Dzogchenpa. Yeah. There you go. He's the vice president. Dzogchenpa is the president. Padmasambhava is the vice president. Padmasambhava is very intense. I was always startled by him. He looked like a maniac. But now I look at his picture and I just love it. That picture of that statue, I just say, ah. Wow. I just wow it. It's extremely wow. There you go. There's the VP. We have our VP, Padmasambhava. The lotus born. Now if we say, you know, Jesus didn't ask me to do this for him. This is more along Chempa. Because if we said, oh yeah, Jesus for president, well, people say, oh, freaking of evangelical, crazy nutcase. You know, that's just like immediately a non-starter. People will just reject the heck out of it. And then the Christians will try to say, yeah, Jesus is that's the only name, nothing else. You know, they'll get into this conventions. Those are conventions. I don't reject the conventions at all of Christianity. I embrace them, but I understand they're not authoritative. They're conventions. They're pragmatic conventions. But beyond that is your own clarity. So, Dzogchenpa for president, Padmasambhava for vice president. We have our vice president on the 24th. So, the Donald got his vice president. Ms. Clinton got her vice president. And now, Dzogchenpa got its vice president, Padmasambhava. Yes. And the cabinet, Dzogchenpa is certainly perhaps going to be what? Secretary of State? Jamyang Genchi Choki Lodro. Minister of the Interior? Environmental Czar, maybe? Something like that. Environmental Czar. Hey, I like the cabinets, you know, going to take shape at some point. We'll put these Enigma Masters as cabinet members. That'll be the cabinet members. Minister of Finance, Secretary of State, Secretary of Finance, Secretary of the Interior. Put the Enigma Masters in charge of those bureaucratic posts. Absolutely. So, Dzogchenpa, Padmasambhava, 2020. And so we're going to kick off, we're not going to wait till the elections have taken place. We're going to kick off our campaign right now for 2020. Because I tell you that nobody's going to be satisfied. Whoever wins, most people are going to be a lot of people, half and half, are going to be extremely dissatisfied. I can tell you right now, if Clinton wins, I'm going to be extremely dissatisfied. If Trump wins, I'm going to be nervous. I'm just being honest. I'm a pragmatist, okay? I'm going to be somewhat nervous. Just because the volatility that's going to bring, it's, you know, so it's not like if Trump wins, everything's going to be fine. No, it's going to be very volatile because there's going to be civil disobedience, maybe a civil war in the United States. And he is a wild card. Okay, we don't know exactly what he would do. I mean, he can be abrupt. I mean, so you don't know. He's nervous. But if Clinton wins, well, it's just, you know, it's hell. I mean, just it's the worst possible scenario. So you're going to have, either way it goes, You're going to be nervous, going to be agitated, going to be unsettled. So we already know this, right? So why are we sitting here uninspired, like, okay, I don't know what I'm going to do? No, Dzogchenpa, it's Padmasambhava 220, and let's start on the election right now. Let's get that 2020 campaign rolling. Now, what does this do? Provides us a focus so we can be on the sidelines of everything that's going on. Say, no, well, you have the power right now. Well, fine, but we're going to take the White House, so to speak, which is, symbolizes, you know, global power, so to speak, the mood. We're going to take it in 2020, and we're going to start working on that right now. We think that people will turn to this in great numbers because of the supreme dissatisfaction. They say, oh, you don't have a chance. Well, yeah, that's what they said about Trump, right? You don't have no chance. So we're saying Dzogchenpa Padmasambhava 2020. Now, this is not going to be completely dominated by the Tibetans or anything. No, I'm here too, you know. actually, Dzogchenpa is probably, and Jamyang and Padmasambhava has put this in the Holy Spirit, and Jesus has put this idea into my mind to launch this campaign. So I'm not deficient in you know, austerity and spiritual practice and all the stuff the Tibetans have. I'm not deficient in that. I view them as my colleagues, but I'm not, you know, some awestruck, you know, by them. I'm not at all awestruck by them. I respect them as great colleagues, you know, and perhaps, you know, more, you know, further than me, but still a colleague. You know, it's like, you know, okay, you're you know, you both have PhDs, but someone has done a lot of publishing and a lot of stuff, and then, you know, oh, great, you know, you've written a lot of books. You know, oh, okay, wonderful, good. But I, you know, I'm still like a PhD at it. You know, I still, you know, I know, so, you know, don't, nobody's gonna try, you know, pull rank on me in that way. I don't. You know, you've done the work, you have the discipline, you know how to practice, you've had the experiences, you have the contacts. I mean, I have familiarity with these Dharma kings directly, not Padmasambhava yet, that I know of. It's possible that I did meet him, but there was no name or form given, really. I have had experiences of this, just the living light itself, in this golden light sort of form. It was just so wowish, you know. It was like the Dharmakaya body or something, you know. And maybe that was Padmasambhava. Yeah, the Lotus Party. The Lotus Party. The Thousand Petaled Lotus Party. The Thousand Petaled Lotus Party of Dzogchenpa and Padmasambhava. And this, you know, it. Now, does that mean I'm not paying attention to other Dharma kings? No. I'm paying even more attention all the time. As I said, Jesus has invited me to go to his dwelling place. Certainly, I will do so at the right time, if this is what's going to happen. But this only clarifies what Jesus' message is, because it's exactly Jesus' message. Truth doesn't have a different message, actually. It's all the same. Holy instant. Abide in the holy instant. Abide in the vision of Christ, which is, change your perception. Change the purpose that you give perception. This is what Tibetan Buddhism is about. This is what Jesus is about. It's all the same. And they say Jesus must have studied with them. And I say, well, maybe they study with Jesus. Or maybe both. Okay, so let's not get stuck in convention here. Okay, we're not stuck in convention here at all. Dzogchenpa Padmasambhava 2020. How about that, folks? So, wow, this is great. This has just suddenly changed my whole outlook. I was back on my heels, you know. I was getting hit by this, hit by that, you know. But, you know, I did a little rope-a-dope. Strong enough to do a little rope-a-dope. As comes Muhammad Ali, you let the other one punch themselves out. But so yeah, I was getting punched, absorbing the blows, absorbing the blows. Okay, now I'm off the ropes again. Off the ropes again. Able to go backwards. I might even, actually, I'm kind of feeling like I want to try that out today, even though I'm tired, but I might. Is like start running backwards and walking backwards and doing stuff backwards. I did that yesterday, did some of that. Maybe that's why my legs are tired. I did work out yesterday. I forgot about that. I really did. So, you know, this is my contribution to everyone. There's super grace to this. It takes this. It's not whimsical at all. It's very pragmatic. It's super pragmatic. So we don't get on the ropes of like, well, who are you supporting? Who are you going to throw your weight behind? But I've already thrown my weight behind the 2020 campaign of Sogchamp because I feel neither one of these candidates, I think both of them may be disasters. And I'm not going to sit around waiting for that to happen. I think it's a certainty that there's going to be great unrest no matter who wins. Absolute certainty. So I don't want to get caught up in that dust. So we're going to start our grassroots campaign. We're all focused on Dzogchen Babasaba 2020. As offering, we're going to be Johnny on the spot offering an alternative to people as they realize, oh my God, this is a disaster. And then we say, well, look, we have a political party you can join, so to speak, because people want to be feel they've joined some a action, activist, political party, something that's going to do something. And we say, yeah, we'll bring back moral austerity. We'll bring back materialistic austerity. We'll bring back spiritual practice. We'll bring back mood of repentance. And that's what'll really set the world right. That's what'll really set the world right. So support this. So throw your weight behind this. Let's set up our campaign headquarters. Let's open an office. I'm checking out. I'm going to check out a headquarters. This is what I'm going to do. This is what my purpose is. I have a place in mind that is going to be a headquarters, and we can invite people there to start talking about this campaign. Seriously. Now, are they going to be on the ballot? You know, if we have to go through those steps, we could do it. File, you know, official file and stuff. All that officialdom, you know, is something that me, you know, if that comes, it comes. Now, maybe not a lot of people will do this, but maybe some will. And maybe it'll gather momentum, actually. This is not whimsicality. We're very serious about this. So we're getting in shape. We'll get in shape. Now, we're not against healthy living. We're not against the yoga girl thing of, you know, healthy food, healthy living. Fine. That's part of the austerity thing. Okay. But it goes way beyond that. Moral austerity. Okay. Personal austerity. How you present yourself, your body language, your attitude, your mood. It's mood of repentance is the core of it. And full stop in the wild practice is the core of it. Oh, that's the core. This other stuff is okay. But this is not an ecstatic movement. Where it's a sober, you know, it's a sober, austere feel to it. At the same time, we're not robotic, but we it's not a crazy wisdom type of movement thing. It's not a sex, drugs, rock and roll sort of thing. Those things were austere. It's more austerity than that. much more austerity. Discipline and austerity is at the root of it, so that we can practice more. And the breaking out of roboticism, we don't overdo that. This has been overdone before by various movements in the 70s, 80s, 90s. There were these various guru movements where the people were just, you know, let's just chant and scream and go crazy and yeah, guru, guru. You know, it's just like, well, that had its place, okay? So we're not putting it down. But now we have to be more austere and disciplined than that. And we're not devotees, we're now gurus in the making. So we take the position of a guru from the beginning. And a guru has to set the right tone. Like Longchampa criticized the crazy wisdom adepts and those who went about that way. He said, that's not setting the right tone. Okay, I don't go for that. I want, you know, moral austerity. You know, how you behave in public is very important. How you conduct yourself is important. We're not robotic, but you need to set the right tone that says, look, this is serious, and this is getting down to business here, okay? We're not just trying to get into a mood of ecstasy here. Like in the hippies and the hippies and the ravers, you know, there's this, people are like frantic to break out of this roboticism, so there's these gurus that come, so, you know, there's these call them what you want, to some call them gurus, whatever. And they say, okay, right, let's rave, you know, let's just, you know, let's be orgastic, you know, in instead of robotic and stuff. Okay, this is cultivating devotees. Okay, we're not into that. It's a different focus. We're not putting that down, because for some that's a necessary step. Okay. But we're not doing that here. Okay, that's not welcome here. We're sober. We're conservative. We're sober. We're austere. And when we practice with a purpose. When we're spontaneous with a purpose. When we walk backwards, we're walking backwards in a sober way. We're not, you know, like that man showed me the way. He showed me the way. He was an Asian man, a Chinese man, I believe, but a sober Chinese man in a certain way. There are different types of Chinese. There's the belligerent ones, and then there's the wise, sober ones. You don't want the belligerent ones in charge, believe me. No, you do not. And so he was just walking very soberly backwards. He wasn't drawing any attention to himself or anything. But I noticed, I mean, he got my full attention. I said, wow, I gotta take a look, I gotta get going on this. So, that's very ultra, or what do you call it, like outrageous, like what? Somebody's just walking backwards down a path? But that's the way he did it, is saying, this is important to me. I'm doing this out of wisdom. I'm not trying to act like I'm some crazy adept. Okay? We're not acting like we're a crazy adept. There's no crazy adept in charge here. I'm not a crazy adept. And I won't be. Okay? So if you're looking for that, you got to go elsewhere. Nor am I a New Age feel-good guru or something. No, New Age guru. No, absolutely not. So, if nobody's looking, you know, maybe I'll walk backwards, practice walking backwards. But if someone's there and there's a problem, then I'll go back walking forward and just smile, or just, you know, like, my attitude is just like, I'm just into this for myself. I'm not trying to force you into doing it. And then people, you know what, people just like to leave you alone. They leave you alone. Say, okay, he's okay. I mean, people's attitude towards me is like, I don't see anything, any trouble here, really. He's okay. He's not trying to make trouble. He's not trying to, you know. So, okay. Live and let live. I'll mind my, he's minding his business, I'll mind my business. That's fine. So I don't get hassled. I haven't been hassled. You know, I don't get hassled. People don't hassle me, really, because I don't try to hassle them. But some of these hippies and goes those went on with the raving, hippie raving, spiritual raving thing. Yeah, they kind of tried to, you know, hassle others, like, hey, you know, look at us, we're so free and you're not. You know, no, it's not like that. We're so ecstatic, orgiastically ecstatic, and you're not. We're not hung up, man. Whatever feels good, do it, man. No. We're not like that, you see. No. Because we're taking the position of guru from the start. Okay? This is what we do. This is what Padmasambhava, you can see. You realize if you try to be a devotee, whoa, it's too much. But if you take the position of guru from the start, oh, I love it. I want to be like Padmasambhava, just like that. It's completely different, depending. So there are many who want to be devotees, who are afraid of their own inner clarity, and they want someone else to just act it out for them, and then they follow the actions. Where's the action? But no, we're here to experience our own inner clarity that arises within us. That's guru vision. We're here to experience guru vision. So our goal is to say, I'm already experiencing guru vision, and one insight has indeed settled it all for me. So we take that from the very beginning as our position, from the very beginning. Okay. So we're attracting gurus here, not devotees. So I'm starting to take little baby steps, inviting people. Say, maybe you want to come out here, do this and that. I met someone yesterday. It was quite extraordinary, and I actually invited to host him at a golf course. I said, you know what? Never played there. Look, he was not sure about playing. Are you sure? He said. Is it really good? Really? And I said, look, I'll host you there. I'll invite you out there and I'll host you there, and I'll show you around. Super great golf course. I'll show you around. I've never done that before. I've never invited anyone to anything or hosted anything, but I'm starting to do that. So look, come on out, fly out to Southern California. I'll host you there. I'll show you around, host you there, make you feel comfortable. So maybe I'll just host the dignitaries that come out to, you know, the I'll just help make them feel comfortable. I don't know what you call that, concierge or something. Possible. Very possible, actually. And we'll have a headquarters. We'll set up headquarters and get this campaign, Dzogchenpa Padmasambhava 2020. Pragmatically, we acknowledge that he's not, you know, this candidate is not, this candidacy is not going to win 2016. But pragmatically, we also realize that really nobody's going to win 2016. And if martial law is declared, then that's even worse. That's the worst case scenario. But there are those who are working on that. The POTUS is working on that, has been for a long time. So our perspective is nobody's going to win this election, so let's win the 2020 election. Let's win that one. Right? How about that? We just leap over the whole situation like this. Brilliant. Super grace. Super grace. The brilliant move of super grace. Here's the brilliant chess move of super grace. Because you know what? I mean, if you're still going to be in this world by 2020, you better have a focus to get you there. Now, maybe I could just leave the world right now, but that may not happen. I'm okay with that. I'm set up. I committed in August of 2015 to at least be prepared to stay here for a while, if it came to that. So that's why I started dieting and working out and having a presence here. Holy Spirit said, if you want to do this, could you help me out in this way? Longchenpa asked me, could you help me out in a certain way? I said, sure, I'll give it a try. I decided to give it a try. And I've been dedicated to this now. I hit my weight, 174.4 this morning. There's the 44 again. There's the 44 again. Yeah, very interesting. Amazing. So I was under my weight by half a pound, under my weight, my target, and I wanted to be under it. That was the greatest goal, not just some 175 point something, but under it. And I did it, under it. Tremendous. Physically, the way I feel, look, it's okay. I don't feel so great. Got some, my back's still hurting me here, and I'm tired, get sleepy, but there's a stress, severe stress and all that. But I did the workout. I mean, I'm ready to go in some role for this campaign. Campaign manager, I don't know. It's possible. Or what is it, press secretary, or what do you do when you help host people? People come to the headquarters. I say, let's play some golf. Host them, let's show them the sights, relax here by the pool, play some golf. Let's settle in. Let's get the vibe of this campaign. Help people get the vibe of this campaign. Some role like that. It'll come. It'll come. It'll come. Someone will mention something and say, oh yeah. So I'm gonna go check out an area conducive to guests coming and visiting, staying there while then they can visit the campaign headquarters and stuff. I've had this in my mind for a long time that we need to set up some sort of headquarters where and people can start being galvanized around a nucleus of an alternative focus. Do not struggle with the focus that the world is presenting us. Get an alternative focus and work on and a super positive alternative focus and start working on that. This is what I believe is the remedy. It's just like bad habits. Don't struggle with them. Get a good habit and then focus on that. Maybe Jam Yang does many things. Maybe he's a doctor too. The doctor, the campaign doctor. He said, "Doc, fix my back, doc. I need a few things fixed here." They can do that, actually. I really need this ache I have in my back is bothering me for some reason. Doesn't want to go away. It's some sort of tension, obviously. So we're brainstorming here. We're flipping the script, obviously. We're doing flipping the script in this video, mostly. Is right on cue, we have an alternative focus, and we have the ticket. Right on the 24th. Perfect timing. Perfect timing. Like I said, I'm always on time. This is my life. I'm always on time. Right when you need to have some, that's when it happens. Someone says, be here by this time. I'm there, right on the dot. Even with not even paying attention to time, it just happens. I walk in a room, I haven't been paying attention to time. They asked me to be there at, 3:30 or something. I look at the clock and the second hand goes click, 3:30 to the second or something. I'm like, wow, how'd that happen? I got stuck in traffic. I made a wrong turn. All this, I thought I'd be late. No, exactly on time. I cannot explain it at all. It's something that has always astonished me in my life, is how is this possible? So I'm not even paying attention a lot of the times. And all this stuff happens, I think, oh my gosh, that's messed everything up. And yet it enabled me to go to be there at exactly the right moment. So, grace is beyond our capacity to comprehend it conceptually at all. It's perfect. It's just, it's all-knowing, all-perfect. And so it knocks you out. Who's going to be the first lady of Dzogchenpa? Maybe Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma will be the first lady. There you go. She is the queen of all Dakinis, after all. I know Yeshe Sogo was a consort of Pahasama, but Sri Sri, maybe that was, queen of all the Dakinis. Vajrayogini, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma is Vajrayogini, queen of all Dakinis, as an appearance. She's really super grace, just like Pavasama, super grace, etc. But how did she appear to the world? So maybe she's the first lady. There you go. That completes that. So you need to have Dzogchenpa. Is the president, first lady, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. The vice president is Pamasamava. And his consort, maybe, Yeshe Sogo, or but the wife of the vice president generally is not, it's not a big deal. Lesser of importance. First lady has a pretty strong role, actually, in setting the tone. She usually dictates to the man anyway. Nancy Reagan, Hillary Clinton, whatever this one is in now. And the feminist behind it all. What's her name? Michelle, okay, the one now, and they dictate a lot of policy to the president, a lot. You don't think Nancy